living experience. So that part is already started actually. So now you can use your cell phone to switch on your air conditioner. If you use your Samsung Galaxy, any model, and if you go to the Android market, there is one air conditioning application from the Samsung. If you put same air conditioner which is listed there in their list, so you can use your Samsung Galaxy Note or any other device to switch on your air conditioner which is at home, because they are using the same technology and they are using the devices which are connected. So from your Samsung Galaxy cell phone, you can switch on your air conditioner at home. So suppose you will be reaching your home after 15 minutes. So at least 5 or 10 minutes your air conditioner will take to make the temperature at your desired level, right? So when you are on your way, you just switch on your air conditioner, and when you will enter your home, you will find your temperature as you desire. So that is part of the ambient intelligence. Same thing, when you enter the home, you can switch on the lights from your phone. So all those embedded sensors and other things are installed, and it is to make your life more convenient. Then there is another example, like digital camera. I will show you its implementation. So it captures images, stores images in digital format without any film, multiple images stored in camera, and number depends on amount of memory and bit used per image, and finally downloads image to the PC. And using the system on chip, multiple processors and memories on one IC, that is possible in your digital camera. High capacity flash memory you can use, and very simple description used. For example, many more features with real digital camera, variable size images, image deletion, digital stretching, zooming in and out, and blah blah. There are many applications which can be done using this type of digital camera. So if you look at Sony or any other company's digital camera these days, these are very compact, very light in size, because they are using this system on chip applications. Okay, so if you look at the user point of view for a digital camera, the user turns on the camera, points it towards the object and clicks the shutter button. The user can take images as long as there is space available in the memory. It's a very simple function. But if you look from the designer's perspective, from a designer point of view, the operation of digital camera can be described as a finite state machine, FSM. So it is from our point of view, I think I should skip all these things. So that thing is done using a CCD or the image sensor. So first of all, special sensor that captures an image. Light sensitive silicon solid state devices composed of many cells, these are known as the CCD devices. And then there are CMOS sensors. CCD is cheaper and CMOS are very expensive. So these two types of sensors or devices are used to take the picture. And then we compress that image. Okay, so like JPEG. JPEG is the common format which is used to compress those images, to store more images. And then like here, you can see a picture. This is the scene. We have a lens, then we have color filter array, then imaging array, and then input processor. Then we do color engine will do its task, and then there are different functions which are there to remove any noise or any distortions from your image. And finally, it is stored in the JPEG or MPEG encoding format. So this is the basic way how a digital camera works. So if you look at the implementation of that digital camera, you can see here we need just 8051 microcontroller. Most of the computer science people are aware of that. We need a RAM and double EEPROM and CCDP and UART. So this is the basic architecture if you want to implement that digital camera on a single chip. That is one possible implementation. Then there is another one where codec is also on chip. Sometimes codec is not on chip and you are using software part for that one. And sometimes like DCT or any algorithm which you are writing can be implemented directly on the hardware. And sometimes we are using software for that. And this is a digital camera SoC implementation. As you can see, it is more complicated than the previous one. This is the complete SoC architecture of your digital camera. As far as presenting some research here, so that was just introduction about system on chip and its applications. So if I start talking about my research, I think that will not be a good idea here. So I will just give you a brief introduction like how we develop some simple applications. So it is just the making a very simple auto-focusing function. So as you know that whenever you are taking a picture, you have to focus the camera.
Right.
So we use that using an autofocus function. So autofocus is the function which is used for this purpose. So measuring the exact degree of focus, suppressing several electronic noises, that is the target, and low power implementation. So power should be very less and the exact degree of the focus. So this is the focus measure. Performance parameter to measure the degree of the focus determined by the amount of high frequency components of a signal in a frame. So for example, FM of image A is larger than B means that image A is more clear than image B. So we calculate it. There is a scene of which we want to take the picture. So the device will automatically calculate. We call it focus measure. So the lens will be focused at that particular position and the picture will be taken. So we call it autofocusing. And then the searching algorithm which finds the in focus position with minimum moving steps. As you are having a lens, it should not be moved arbitrarily because there are the chances of destroying it. So there should be minimum step. So the searching algorithm, as you can see here, lens position on the lower picture, as you can see at the center point it's most clear, and whenever you are going this side or that side the picture is blurred. So that is the function. So the autofocusing is first to calculate the focus measure and then the searching algorithm will fix it. So there are many traditional focus measure operators. You can see there, but there are some problems when the object step aside the center window. This is the center window of your camera. So sometimes the object is moving. So in that case, it is very difficult to focus. So this is one case. Second case, when the background has a higher frequency than the target object. Sometimes the background is more prominent than the target object. In that case, it is very difficult to focus. Then third case is that there are multiple objects in the center window. Then again, it is a problem. So our task was to develop autofocus algorithm for this type of cases. So we used mid-frequency discrete cosine transform, DCT, which is less affected by various electrical noises and passive autofocus algorithm. And the reason for using DCT is that it has shown efficient and robust performance. So we have calculated this in this form, calculating the parameters. Then if you look at this table, these are 64 coefficients of DCT. one DC and 63 AC coefficient, and then we arrange them according to their frequencies. And finally, we studied the effect of each and every coefficient on the image performance. And then, as you can see from these pictures, that the components or the coefficients which were most prominent or which were deciding the picture quality were chosen, and our algorithm was developed like this one. We call it focus measure FM, MFDCT. So this is the operator, and then we developed the searching algorithm. So this was the top level block diagram of this autofocus function. Lens shading correction, bad pixel cancellation, color interpolation, all these things were done, and then search one, focus measure, object detection, and we used fuzzy reasoning for the searching algorithm also, and then we did the focus measure and finally implemented it on a chip. So these were the performance comparison of our work with others, and this was the test environment. So the pictures were taken like comparison of traditional and proposed searching algorithms. So these are some of the cases which you can see here. So like on the last picture, the target object is on the side and something else is there in the center. You can see here. So our target is to focus here, not here, because he is the main player and he is just spectator. So this type of cases are there which we have studied and tried to do. So our algorithm was able to do it successfully, and this was the block diagram, and finally the publications. Thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions, then please ask.
So before going to the questionnaire, let me take 5 minutes. Have you heard about quantum computer? Quantum computer. You are all computer people. Have you ever heard this word, quantum computer? Actually, what I'm taking these 5 minutes is a person from basic background of computer science. Do you know? And he has done a lot of works in electronics and biochips and a lot of work in different areas which are not concerned from the computer science as we say. That is the part. We are a people of computer science, we are not bothering about electronics. That is the point. There is no limitation. I'm taking this word quantum computers. The reason is the quantum computer person is and his name is Love Grover. You just go to the Google, type quantum computers, you will find the name Love Grover. He is from India. He has done his schooling from Roorkee. He has done his B.Tech from IIT Delhi. And you know which one? He has given the algorithms of quantum computers, and for that people are searching the hardware with the hardware which can implement the algorithms provided by the Love Grover. And if I let you know the number by which the processing speed can increase if we can get the hardware to incorporate those algorithms, and that number is 10 raised to power 12 times. Can you imagine? 10 raised to power 12 times will be the processing speed from today if we can get the hardware to incorporate those algorithms which we call it quantum computers. Now the point is, the person who has proposed the algorithms is from India. He has done his B.Tech from IIT Delhi, then he has done his MS from US, and presently is working, after doing his PhD, he is working in Bell Labs. Okay, can you guess from which branch he has done his B.Tech from IIT Delhi? Anything else? Computers is always number one because he has given the algorithms for the quantum computers. Any other guess? Please raise your hand if you want to say something. Just guess the branch. He has B.Tech from mechanical engineering. And he has given the algorithms for quantum computers. So area doesn't matter in which you are working. What are you doing? That is important. Whatever field you have chosen, it doesn't matter. Whatever you have done, it matters. So the message is, go beyond the boundaries. Don't think that we are a computer people. We are not bothering about the bio, we are not bothering about the engineering branches and other things, electronics, we are not bothering. So whatever you can get from a person, it can be utilized at any stage of the life. Because after doing this work, nobody can say that I'll go in this direction, I'll go in this direction. He was confident that he'll go in this direction after doing BSc in computer science in early 90s or last 80s. But he has done a lot of work in different areas. So the subject, from my point of view, doesn't matter. So I think I have taken more than 5 minutes. And now the questions, if you can, if you are interested to ask any question regarding his field of area or any question, if you want to ask.
Which has been your area of work besides looking at digital camera application? This field specifically, did you work and get results for some other application or other device also?
Like biomedical implementations, we worked on the cardiac pacemaker and we implemented that chip, and that is also used by a company. So all those things which I have shown are actually developed by us. Any other questions? Pardon? Yeah. You mean to say the degree or type of languages?
Languages.
Languages. So that's why I needed a marker. I wanted to do some marker. So like you use C and C++, those are the software programming languages. Same way in hardware, we use hardware description languages, HDLs. So like Verilog is one language, and then VHDL is another language. Those are for designing the chips. And when we are working at the system level, so there is an extension of C language which we call System C. So those languages are specifically designed for the system on chip applications. Its name is System C, but its basics are similar to the C language. System C, Verilog, VHDL. These are the three basic languages we use. Verilog is derived directly from C language. So if you know C, there is no problem to understand Verilog and System C. And VHDL is derived from Ada, a very old language. So as you know, Agusta Ada was a very famous mathematician. So after that scientist's name, we use this language.
I can note it down here. So like System C, then Verilog, and VHDL. These are the three basic languages which we use for the programming. And as I told you, I will tell you one basic difference.
Like in software programming language, when you want to add two numbers, you write Z equal to A plus B. And the output is available immediately, right? So if A is 5, B is 6, then Z is equal to 11. Okay? But we are the hardware people. In our case, every circuit or every system has some time delay. That is the most important part of the hardware. So when I write z equal to a plus b, then I need to mention the time, after how much time we are getting that output. So we are not getting that output immediately, we are getting it after a time delay. So the basic difference between these languages is that they include the hardware part. So the time delay statements are included. So you use the same C-type language for the behavior description, describing the behavior of your systems, but you need to include the hardware part also, where you have to mention clearly that how much time your signal is taking from going one place to another. So that's the basic difference. Otherwise the basic concept is same. So we use Verilog, for example, is very simple. It's just extension of C language. But you can say that C is a subset of Verilog. Verilog uses three different sections or three different sets, you can say. One is similar to say, where you use if-else statements, case statements, every other statement which you use in C, that is behavior part of Verilog. Then one part is the data flow part, which we call as this one, mentioning the time. And third part is the structural part of Verilog. In the structural part, we define how the different components inside a system are connected. So actually, Verilog is not a one language. These are actually three languages. So one is C and two others are hardware descriptions. But if you want to start work in that area, it's very easy because you people already know C and C++, so you can easily define. And if you go to the system C level, there you need not to worry about those hardware part. There we are concerned only about the software. We have to describe the behavior of our system. Whatever we want to design, we will explain it, its behavior using system C language. And then we have the automatic softwares which will generate a structure for our chip. So we need to define the behavior. So behavior means inputs and outputs and some controls. Like any system is actually treated like a black box. So you are giving some inputs and you are getting some outputs. And third part is some control inputs, how you are controlling. So that's the black box type modeling. So in C language, we can easily do it. We just mentioned that these are our inputs and these are our outputs, and we have some control inputs. And then how our system is behaving. So we need to mention the behavior.
Any other questions? If there are no more questions, let us thank Dr. Yogendra Kumar for his talk.
Thank you.
Next thing is going to have to go here. And if you people want to discuss anything, he is here up to the evening. And after that, he'll be invited to Korea next week. So thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to thank Sir for taking our time from his busy schedule and addressing the gathering on topics of interest like system on chip and its application like implantable biomedical applications, ambient intelligence, etc. Thank you so much, Sir, for sharing your knowledge with us. Looking forward for further association with our institute, ARDAIS. Thank you so much, Sir.
Thank you.